Welcome to this 30th lecture. Right, so we will see here torque speed characteristic of an induction motor. How do we estimate by using time harmonic formulation that we saw in the previous two lectures. Right, so now here governing partial differential equation is this. So this you are familiar with this, except the change here is, see, actually it is sigma dA by dt, is it not? So dA by dt, d by dt is replaced by j omega, and again there is now one more s. This is the slip of induction motor, because depending upon the frequency of induced EMF, you have to take either s as whatever slip frequency. Suppose it is rotor, you have to take the corresponding slip. If it is stator, then it will be s will be equal to 1, right. So depending on, so we are generalizing this. So s into omega, right. Rest is of course same. So now we know from the induction motor theory that torque, if we take the rotor losses, then torque is given by P rotor losses upon s times omega, right. Now here, if you see this geometry, there is this rotor, which is steel, and we are considering this as solid iron, because here it is, slip is very small, so induced frequency is very small, so the eddy current losses will be quite small. So we can consider this rotor as solid, it is not laminated, whereas this stator, the outermost part, this stator, this steel is laminated steel, right. But here we are not interested in loss calculation, so we will not be defining the conductivity for this stator also, right. And another thing, there are two more simplifications in this model. This stator does not have teeth, so there are only these coils A plus, A minus, B plus, B minus, C plus, C minus, there are no teeth, these are not the teeth. So it is like this outer path is just path for the containment of flux, and so that the flux is contained within this geometry. And so basically you have this complete as sort of air gap, right. And then you have this rotor is in the form of this aluminum ring, so this entire this part is aluminum. So instead of you have in squirrel cage induction motor, for example, you have the cage having aluminum bars, is it not, which are short circuited at both ends. So here we are simplifying that model as simply aluminum. Now and then you have this all these as I explained, A plus, A minus, and all those. Now this source for these geometries, this website, wherein these are what are called as team workshop problems. These are standard benchmark problems. Whenever you get on to any complex FEM based analysis, here you have an option to verify your FEM methodology by solving some standard benchmark problems given in this website, right. So I will just show you that website. So here, for example, you see here there are number of problems given at this website, and then you can just open any of those problems and detail, some theory is given, problem definition is given, results are given. So you can model any of these problems which are of interest to you and verify your FEM analysis, right. So this is a very useful website, with number of problems given, static, time harmonic, transient, right, coupled problems, coupled circuit field problems, right. So we have taken this geometry from this website, and the problem is 30A, right. So of course this is a simplified geometry. So now this is a 3-phase 2-pole induction motor. Now you can see here, we are actually, what we are going to do is, we are going to define peak current for A phase. So A plus is peak current. So B plus and C plus coils will have negative half, right? So that means B minus and C minus will have positive half currents. So this is positive peak, and these two will be, this will be positive half peak. So together, you know, you will say this is plus plus plus. This is say one per unit. This is half half. So together, you know, you will have
flux contours
which will be enclosing all these positive currents. Of course, they are displaced in time. This is positive peak. This is half positive peak. But there will be, you know, you can expect to see flux pattern which will be, you know, like this. Similarly, here A minus will be negative peak, and C plus and B plus will be also negative half peak. So this, so there will be another set of
flux contours
which will be enclosing these three coils, right? So now let us, before going into this, let us just compare the flux plot that we have got. So as I was explaining, you have got
one set of contours like this and another set of contours like this.
So I hope you understood the geometry and ampere turn definition. We basically solve this, we discretize this. This will give you the global coefficient matrix which will have geometry and material information. This will give you D matrix, is it not? We have seen it earlier, D matrix. This will give you Bj matrix. So now here we already saw torque is given by rotor losses divided by S into omega. Now here omega is the synchronous speed in radians per second, right? So S is nothing but omega synchronous minus omega r, that is the rotor speed, upon omega, right? So that is slip. And f, we are taking it 60 hertz because in this problem here frequency is 60 hertz, right? So we are taking it as 60 hertz. So slip is omega minus omega r upon omega, where omega corresponds to synchronous speed, okay? So now having got the solution A, then what we can do is we can then find out E. E is nothing but minus daba A by daba T, right? And that means it will be minus j omega A, right? And then you can then substitute, then find out the amplitude of E, and then substitute it here. Sigma is the conductivity. Now in terms of, you can directly calculate this in terms of j also, then in that case the formula becomes rho j square dv, where rho is the resistivity, right? Because E is nothing but j upon sigma. So this will be j square upon sigma square. So j square upon sigma, because this sigma 1 will go. So it will become j square by sigma. 1 upon sigma is rho. So sometimes you will find in the text and in some commercial softwares, they will quote this formula, rho j square dv. So rho j square and sigma I square, they are the same thing. And as I previously mentioned, this rho j square or this sigma I square, that has the unit of watts per meter cube. So the dimensions of this you know, geometry are given here. So various radii are given here, 2, 3, 3.2, 5.2, 5.7. So remember, this is a very simplified geometry, just for the verification purpose. So as we have been, you know, earlier also discussing, the advantage with finite element method is it is like sort of geometry independent, the procedure. So if your finite element solution works for this geometry, which is very sort of trivial or simplified geometry, it will definitely work for a complicated geometry, real geometry of a motor with all the details modeled correctly, right? So that is the advantage of finite element analysis. So this, you know, we have already seen this plot. Now this is for a slip of 0.05, which is the actually practical slip value, whereas slip of 0.47 is not practical, because the torque speed characteristic, if you see, the operating region or the stable region is this region, is it not? This is unstable region. So S is equal to, you know, 0.5 will come somewhere, you know, here, which is unstable. But just for comparison purpose, we have plotted for S is equal to this value also, which corresponds to speed of 200 radius per second for 60 hertz case, because this for this value, that problem 30A has the, you know, corresponding value for which you can actually verify, right. So so then you get losses in aluminum and losses in rotor steel as this. This is calculated from this formula. This is just for verification purpose we are taking this. Practically this slip is not possible, and you can also see that because of slip being high, the induced currents and the corresponding distortion will be high. That is why you can see that the flux pattern here is considerably distorted as compared to S is equal to 0.05, right. So then our purpose is to plot torque speed characteristics. So what we do is, for we vary slip in this formulation. For every slip we basically solve this PDE, right. For every slip we can calculate eventually this PR, from PR we calculate the torque, and then we plot it here. So this is rotor speed, is nothing but, you can actually, this is nothing but slip, is it not? This is representing slip. So then for every slip or the rotor speed, we can get one torque value, and this is, that is how you can, so that as many FEM simulations will be required as many points you want to plot on this torque speed characteristics. But it is fairly easy, because this is a quasi static calculation, is it not? This is not really a transient. Once you have your code running, you have to just, you know, in fact you can set a outer do loop with S varying from some 0 to 1, and in one go you can actually get all the torque values, is it not? So this is fairly straightforward. Here this just shows, now here for example, this corresponds to the synchronous speed. So that is equal to S is equal to you know, 0 here. So this is just explained here. Omega is 120 f by p in rpm, divided by 60, it, you get rps, revolutions per second. So that comes to twice f by p, and then this is revolutions per second. So if you want to find out radians per second, then you have to multiply this by 2 pi, because one revolution has 2 pi radians. So 2 pi into 2 f by p. So this gives you, you know, 4 pi 60 by 2, because f is 60 in our case, and that gives you 377 radians per second, and that is what, you know, this point is 377 radians per second, right. So this is how we can actually use FE methodology to plot torque speed characteristic of induction motor, right. Now we go to the next topic, axisymmetric problems, right. Now the axisymmetric problems are quite often encountered in our electrical engineering when we deal with coils, mostly circular coils are there, and if we can simplify some geometrical details and make it sort of, you know, symmetrical about axis, then this axisymmetric formulation is really good, because it gives, by doing 2D simulation you are effectively getting 3D fields, because fields are independent in phi direction, is it not? So that is why axisymmetric problems can be quite, formulation can be quite handy in analysis of electrical machines and equipment. Now here you know, we are assuming symmetry about z axis, which is quite logical. Then let us see some theory. B is equal to del cross A, and now here you know, J, now this is axisymmetric, J current is in phi direction, is it not? Axis is in z direction, so the current will be in phi direction, right? It is symmetry about z axis, current will be in phi direction, right? So j also will be in phi direction, current density also will be in phi direction, right? If current density is in phi direction, A also will be in phi direction, magnetic vector potential. We have seen in basics of electromagnetics, A is, the direction of A is direction of current or J, is it not? So that is why in this, now when you expand this curl del cross A, then you have A as only with a phi component. So only there is a phi component. And this rho comes here, you know, when you, this is the basic definition of curl in cylindrical coordinates. Here 1 upon rho comes, here 1 rho comes, and here also 1 rho comes, right. So this is basic definition of curl in cylindrical coordinate system. Now if you actually expand this determinant, then you will get this two components, A rho and A z components, right. So which is obvious because J is in phi, so that will lead to B and B having two components in rho and z directions, right. Like when J, earlier case whenever we used to approximate in Cartesian system, we used to take J in z direction, is it not, and then B used to be having x and y components. Similarly here you have J in phi,
will have
rho and z component, right. So now here this rho, this d by dz of rho, so this rho can be taken out, is it not, rho is constant when you are taking derivative with respect to z. So this rho and this rho will get cancelled, so that is why finally you get this expression. So now further, going further, now we calculate J. J is del cross H, right, and H is B upon mu, right. So then you know, you again use curl expansion, and then you get, now here B is having two components, rho and z, right. So that is what is written here, 1 upon mu, this is this 1 more by mu is coming because of this, B rho is this, and B z is this component, right, and B phi is 0 because there is no B phi component, right. Now again you expand, now here J will be in only phi direction, and that can be verified here that, you know, if you take A rho, then D dabba by dabba phi of this will be, you know, because with respect to phi there will not be any variation, is it not, because it is axis symmetric. So D dabba by dabba phi of this will be 0, and this dabba by dabba z of 0 is anyway 0, so that is why A rho component is 0. Similarly you can see A z component, this anyway is 0, D phi dabba by dabba phi of B rho, again since it is symmetrical about z axis, again dabba by dabba phi of this will be 0. So the only component that remains is this A phi, which is dabba by dabba rho of this and minus dabba by dabba z of this, right. So that is what is written here, and then we actually substitute these components here, B rho and B z, and then we are just getting that as J phi. Going further, now what we do, so if we have to use the same formulation that we develop for Cartesian systems in x and y, then we have to make this symmetrical. Now here for example, you know, here it is partial derivative with respect to A phi, whereas here there is a partial derivative with respect to rho A phi. So it is not, you know, symmetrical, is it not? So we can make this symmetrical so that we can apply the same formulation that we developed in xy system for this rho z system. How we can do that? We multiply this numerator and denominator by rho, because rho is constant, is it not? Rho is just constant, and that rho can be taken inside because d by dz, for d by dz rho is constant, is it not? So that is why we take this rho inside and divide by rho, Now you can see this is symmetrical, and then here with respect to our earlier Cartesian systems, what are the changes here? Rho is of course replacing x, z is replacing y, is it not? Right. So I hope you get this Cartesian system. Suppose this axis, this is some coil. If this was xy system, this would have been x, this would have been y. In cylindrical system, now this is rho and this is z, is it not? So this is x is nothing but rho and y is nothing but z in cylindrical systems, right. So that is why rho is replacing s, x, z is replacing y, and rho a is replacing a. Earlier we had only a here, no? And there a was what? Az, is it not? Because there was a two dimensional approximation in xy, so we always took current in z direction, so a was in z direction, so this was actually az there. So that az is now replaced by rho a phi. So now then, if we do this sort of manipulation, then we can exactly use the earlier code for this with no change. Only thing that we have to remember is the solution that we get is not a phi, but it is rho a phi, okay. And then if you want to find out a at any point, then you have to divide that solution value by rho at that point, is it not? Because the solution that we are going to get is rho times a phi. So now at any point, suppose after having got solution, suppose you want to find out actual a phi at this point, what you have to do? You have to actually take that corresponding rho at that point. So that rho a phi divided by rho will give you the a phi at that point, clear? Okay. So if this is, then it is fairly straightforward. So now what another approximation we do for simplifying our calculation is, we consider rho as constant for elements. That means suppose you have some element here, triangular element, actually speaking the rho is changing at every point within the element, is it not? But if the element is fairly small, we can assume for that rho is constant for that element and equal to the centroid rho value, okay. So that at the centroid. Then if we do all these simplifications and then manipulation as explained earlier, then our element coefficient matrix and the corresponding entries will remain exactly, the formula remains exactly same, except we have in the denominator one rho term, the radius, that is the point at which calculations are being made, or the element at which, element in which calculations are being made, right. So here, since we are assuming rho for the that element as constant and at that centroid, that is why you can just write here one rho value. Earlier we had only 1 over mu, is it not? In xy system we had only 1 over mu here. Now here we have 1 over rho mu. So that is why here also mu gets accompanied by rho. And here actually it is mu as a function of b is written. This is actually not valid yet because we have not seen really non-linear analysis. So do not worry about this b, just consider this as just mu. This has to be considered in this form, mu as a function of b, when we actually see non-linearity and we want to model non-linearity, which we will see in a later lecture. So right now this, you consider this as just as mu, because mu is constant over each element and it is a linear system, right. So mu is not a function of b, right. Source matrix remains the same, no change. right, the way we calculated earlier. That means this j phi will result into j delta by 3, and the same procedure applies, right. So now for the going for the calculation of B from A, you get now here, earlier we had A as n1 a1 n2 a2 plus n3 a3. Now we will have rho times A as this, right. And then you have this is the expressions for n1 n2 n3 with x and y now replaced by rho and z, right. This is n1, this is n1, this is n2, this is n3 with x and y replaced by rho and z, okay. Now we have already calculated this b is this, so we are taking that here, right, and then we are actually multiplying and dividing by rho to fit this thing, fit into this, and then now we actually take these derivatives with respect to z and rho. Now this leads to the exactly same expression as earlier for b, except you have gone 1 over 1 over rho, which is logical, is it not? And this is a1 q1 a2 q2 a3 q3, and this q1 q2 q3 are the standard, and p1 p2 p3 are the standard ones as earlier in terms of coordinates, but their x and y will be replaced by rho and corresponding rho and z for the vertices, three vertices, clear. Once you have done that, then of course calculation of energy and inductance, it is straightforward. Now in Cartesian system we had b square upon twice mu as energy density, energy per unit volume. So to that we are multiplying with volume dx dy into dz, but we are taking per meter depth, that is why 1 appears here, is it not? So this is the total energy, b square upon twice mu is energy density, energy per unit volume, okay. In cylindrical system it is the same thing, b square upon twice mu d rho dz. So then how do we in terms of coding, what changes we will have as compared to our 2D Cartesian code? We will have here this mu 0 gets multiplied by, accompanied by rho, as we have seen earlier, in denominator rho comes, so that is the only change, right, because of this rho here in the denominator, right, and b remains same, j delta by 3. Similarly here, now bz and b rho, instead of by and bx, you are now bz and b rho, right, and these expressions we have already seen, these expressions we derived, so corresponding expression is this. Again here additional this rho comes here, which is variable cx here, this is the only thing new. Similarly here for b rho you get this, there is another there is a cx term here in the denominator, right, and then b net is square root of bz square and b rho square plus b rho square, right, and then you calculate the energy for the each element, b square upon twice mu multiplied by 2 pi rho, b square upon twice mu naught into 2 pi rho for each element, and then we have to integrate. So this for one element, then you integrate over sum over all elements, so you will get the total energy.
So in this slide we analyze inductance of a gap core reactor, which was discussed in L24. There is this central core with non-magnetic gaps whose total length is designed to have a particular value of inductance. Most of the energy stored in these gaps, because of their high reluctance, and hence they predominantly decide the inductance value. The central core and the coil are circular and therefore symmetric about the axis. The top and bottom yokes and two side limbs are flat structures with rectangular cross section. Hence, truly speaking, the entire geometry is not axisymmetric. Earlier, we analyzed the same problem using 2D Cartesian system, in which the computation is done for vector depth in z direction. This has essentially assumed that the entire geometry is infinite in extent in z direction, which is not true. However, this approximation is not bad given the large diameters of the coil and the core. Thus, we have understood that both Cartesian and axisymmetric 2D approaches are approximate as summarized here. But they are good enough for inductance calculation. For more accurate computation, one has to do 3D FEM based analysis. The values of inductances given by both methods are close to each other. In the method based on Cartesian coordinates, we had obtained energies per meter depth in various parts and multiplied them by corresponding mean diameters later to obtain the total energy. In the axisymmetric approach, we multiplied elemental energies by corresponding mean diameters at the element level inside the FEM code. So this is another difference between the two models.
So in the next lecture, we will see permanent magnets and the corresponding FE formulation for permanent magnets. Thank you.